and gentlemen, lovers and swingers, it's the end of the week. This is the only thing between you and the pillow. It's time to hit a big note on the bed flute. Time to fiddle, giggle, wriggle. It's time for Club Buggery. Tonight, The Sporting Life presents Club Buggery, live from Bomber Beazley's Hangar, here at the ABC Studios in Gore Hill. Club Buggery, featuring vocalist extraordinaire, the Nissan Cedrics.
Cedrics we are, and this is our story.
Supported by Australia's Rolling Stones, on skins, Mr. Charlie Watts. On bass, Mr. Bill Wyman. On guitar, Mr. Keith Richards. On trumpet, Mr. Brian Jones. And on sax, Mr. Roddy Wood. On keyboards, Mr. Mick Jagger. A big pants off, hawked out, pumped up, Club Buggery welcome to those two vultures of variety, those killers of cabaret, the lairds of Las Vegas, Rampaging Roy Slaven and H.G. Nelson!
Yes indeed, yes indeed. Thanks very much, Terps. Thanks very much, Stones. Thanks very much, Cedrics. Hello, Australasian buggers, and welcome to another Club Buggery for another Friday night. And thanks for joining us on a Friday night when too much variety will be barely enough. And when I say variety, I mean good old-fashioned family values, Australian-style, hip-swinging family variety with the trousers round the ankles as you sashay up to the card table, take a craft single and stick it on a man-sized salada before you get a glass of fruity Lexia. Style of variety. And I can't do better than that, ladies and gentlemen, because you all know what I'm talking about. Club Buggery tonight, coming to you live from the Bomber Beazley Hangar here at the ABC headquarters on Gore Hill. And now I'd like to introduce to you a man who, after years of careful waiting and watching, bagged his first Smith's Crisp gobble dock this week. When Roy bought the stupid dead stuffed animal into the campfire about 3:25 last Tuesday morning, it was large ones all round, and we went to bed tired but happy. But Roy, what or who has been dancing Ludi style on that tiny stage before the dimming footlights of your mind this week, pal?
Yes, thank you very, very, very much, H.G. Nelson. H.G., I'm so buoyant this week. You know, it's been a bit of a down week. It's been a bit of a bummer of a week, but news broke this morning that I'm quite happy to share with Club Buggery viewers and everyone here in the hangar tonight, and that is that one big old boofhead Australian is back. And I refer, of course, to Bugner AJ. Aussie Joe is back in a package that sees he, the George Foreman, in Hungary at some huge soccer stadium that seats 450,000 people. I'll be there, you'll be there, and we'll see all those Bugner moves that I never thought we'd ever see again. We'll see this one. And that one. And I think that sums up Joe's oeuvre, I think. Somewhere between there and there. I mean, it looks so simple.
It does.
But it's brilliant, and I'm glad we're getting... The people of Australia are going... The people of the world, hey, let's face it, and Hungary, are going to see not Aussie Joe, but Hungry Joe back again.
And I think people forget that Aussie Joe's last great bout was in a soccer stadium, White Hart Lane, against the great Frank Bruno.
That's right.
A bout that electrified the world because it exposed the only weakness in Joe's armoury, i.e. the soft spot in the back of his head. And that was the Achilles tendon, if an Achilles tendon can be in the brain box, and I think it can.
With Joe it is.
And so, hence, Joe came back a loser. But I think in Hungary, with his average age now of both combatants over 50, he can come back a winner. And with that as a way of setting the scene here in the Bomber Beazley Hangar, it's an enormous thrill and pleasure to introduce to you a woman who has represented this country at every Pan-Pacific
championship swimming meet there has ever been. She got into the pool for Australia at the tender age of 14. She's hardly been out of it since. She's here tonight dry and clothed. Nissan Cedrics, can you complete the Nicole Stevenson story? Nicole, thanks very much for coming in, and I know you've interrupted a hectic schedule which saw you a couple of weeks ago training at high altitude and then back here and off to New Zealand for a meet in a very, very slow pool. I was very, very disappointed with the speed of that pool. Then off to more high altitude, then down to the Pan Pacific. At your stage, with all these championships behind you and the gold medals, the commie games, the Olympics and so on, how do you keep motivated? How do you keep getting up at 4:30 in the morning, going down to the pool, be driving down, freezing cold, get in and then lie back and just look at the ceiling as you do the backstroke up and down? How do you keep going? Is that too hard a question to ask, Nicole? Is it as simple as thinking, well, I love the sport and I just want to do one more? How do you keep going, Nicole?
Well, I take every year as it comes and every day as it comes, and I guess swimming backstroke, I get to look around a little bit rather than just staring at the black line. I get to look at the roof.
Yes.
I can yawn if I want to, so yeah, I guess just something that I do.
And you've been in it now an awful long time. What advice would you give to, say, a young kiddie who might be living in Hobart or Melbourne in the middle of winter, getting up, being forced out of bed by ambitious parents, down the pool, Freddie, down the pool, Martha? It's dark, I know, it's freezing cold, the pool's got an inch of ice on the top, old speak, a couple of centimetres of ice on top. What words of encouragement would you have for those kiddies?
Probably swim indoors.
Yes.
And try to clear the ice before you get in.
Right.
Yeah. No, but I mean, 2000 coming up, the kids out there just must be really keen, and there's so much to look forward to.
Now I'd like to let Rory off the leash, and I'll take the muzzle off.
Yes, Nicole, my old swimming coach, Grassy Grannell, used to say, take it one stroke at a time. Is that how it is for you? Do you take it one stroke at a time?
I swim probably up to about 160 laps a day. So yes. If I thought about every one stroke,
yes,
those 160 laps, I think, yeah.
Which does beg the question then, Nicole, what do you think about when you're lying there? Sure, you've got the ceiling to distract you. Or if you're outdoors, you can look at the sky and you can look at the billowing shapes of the cumulonimbus clouds and the cirrostratus and that sort of thing, and you can watch the sun go over or the moon rise. But what do you think about when you spend hour after hour after hour going up, going down, going up, going down? What keeps you alert?
Definitely going backwards, swimming backstroke. Yeah. You have to be on your toes with that, otherwise you hit your head on the end.
Yes.
But I guess they say that swimming's good because you get to think about things and it's really calm and soothing, but
yes.
I either think about the last song that I heard on the radio.
Yes.
That goes over and over and over and over,
yes,
in your head.
Yes.
Or I think about nothing, believe it or not.
Yes, no, I can believe that. Do you find there are sometimes songs get in your head that you want to get rid of, that just drive you crazy? You know, it could be Sherbet or Skyhooks or something like that, or AC/DC or In Excess or Pearl Jam, that just drives you crazy and you can't get it out of your head?
Very much so. The good trick's always to try and get someone else singing it and it gets in their head and then they hate you for the rest of the session.
Right. How do you judge where the end of the pool is going to be? Because you've got to do your tumble turn backwards. How do you know? You can't see the black line end. How do you know?
They've got flags there.
Oh.
Flags that are about, I think they're about 10 metres out from the wall, but it's three strokes for me, three backstroke strokes for a turn and four for a touch. Oh. But sometimes you hit your fingers.
Yeah.
And do you take the same number of strokes to do every lap of the pool? When we spoke to Sam Riley recently, she said that she understood how many strokes it had take, and the coach would often pull her up mid-pool and say, what stroke are you on?
Mm.
And when, of course, she didn't have the right answer, she was in for another 50 kilometres that day. only had time to get out of the pool before it was time to get back in, so she just stayed in.
Her stroke's a little bit slower. It's breaststroke, so it's a bit easier to count. So, but there's a lot of emphasis placed on knowing your technique and how many strokes. So,
and technique's become all important, hasn't it? And how has that changed in your time in the caper?
Well, I guess we've had coaches in the past like Laurie Lawrence and people like that that have emphasised just going up and down and doing however many billion laps a day. But now more the emphasis is on having the correct technique for those billions of laps. So,
And what is the most important part of the technique? Is it the cupping of the hand so that you drag more water through, or is it the angle at which the hand penetrates the water to reduce drag? what else? I mean, I can understand those techniques. What else might there be, Nicole?
Backstroke's definitely hip roll and shoulder roll.
Hip roll, shoulder, what, while the hip's going one way, the shoulder's going the other?
Exactly, yeah.
To balance you?
That's right.
Yeah.
And your kick's got to go the opposite way to your shoulder, so.
Right. Are you a 2-beat or 4-beat?
3-beat for backstroke.
3-beat?
Yeah.
Something new. Nicole, we've got some footage of you in action here. I think at the Commonwealth Games, I think it's the 100 metres backstroke in which you put in a lousy heat, but got the lane you wanted, which was, I think, lane one, and you blitzed the field coming home. Let's go to that now. I think we've got the start coming up here. And take us through some of the pointers here. Tactically speaking, were you happy with your heat? You obviously threw the field by coming last qualifying.
Yeah, I wanted to be so that they couldn't see where I was, so I could just, you know, sneak out there. But I almost missed the final. I made the final by 0.3 of a second.
That's right.
So it was a bit of a
mistake. Well, that was well judged.
Very well judged. Now, what are you thinking here, Nicole? You've done the turn. You can probably see the rest of the field over to your left. You can only see one yellow head near you. What were you thinking?
Well, I was thinking someone wave a towel at me so I know whether or not I'm winning or something, but they were. The Australians were waving towels at me and just thinking, please bring the wall closer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, and you were willing the wall closer and closer
to
you.
That's exactly right.
And did you know when you touched that you touched first?
Yeah, I did. The time pads were a little bit slow to come up, but I did know,
Yeah, that must have been a tremendous feeling. And here you are receiving your gold medal. What did you say to this old buffhead when he...
That's actually our FINA representative for the Oceania district.
All right.
He's still an old book. He's got a lot of letters after his name.
What did you say to him?
I just said thank you very much. He said good swim.
Did he?
Said thank you. He's a New Zealander.
He said good swim.
Yes.
And you then sang the anthem without much gusto. Are you unfamiliar with the lyrics? Is that your
No, I'm very familiar with the lyrics. I was just a little bit paranoid of the big screen that was up there showing my face really close.
Right. Can we just discuss just one or two coaches or characters in the game? Now, Laurie Lawrence is a close personal friend of HG and myself.
Yes,
and we can say that Laurie is mad. And I'm sure he wouldn't mind us saying that because we say it to him all the time. Forbes Carlisle, how loony is he? You must have had a fair bit to do with Forbes. I don't trust the bloke.
Yeah.
How do you find it?
Forbes is very active in the letter writing. I think he's cut down a small rainforest in writing letters.
That'd be Forbes.
Yeah. No, he's still very active, but I think he's more in the administration area now rather than the coaching itself.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And when you first saw the Chinese swimmers, did you know they were on drugs?
Well, it was a bit, if you could imagine a 14-year-old girl sitting next to you in the marshalling area, there's only you and seven other people, and they had full sideburns and beards the morning of the swim. Yeah. And they were only 14. They had the physique of Mel Meninga, the body hair of Mel Meninga. You had to
Now, tactics. Is the tactics begin in this marshalling area? You know, you obviously see these big blokes come in and you think, God, I've got to swim against them today, do I? And then you think, well, how can I get the drop on them? Or is it simply a matter of getting out there, getting in the pool, going like the clappers and being the first home? Or is there tactics involved in it?
There is tactics involved. I guess learning how to say there's a drug test coming in Chinese would be a good start. And they'd probably be in the marshalling area. Yeah. But I just try to go out there and do the best I can, which unfortunately isn't as good as what they can do.
Yes, but do you ever say things to them? Like, I used to say in the old days, Mao Zedong, dud. And the message sort of got through. I mean, do you say things like that to them?
No.
And I'm not just singling out the Chinese here. I mean, if you're against a French swimmer, obviously there's a heap you could say to them. Mm. But do you slag them off, so to speak?
No, not at that level. I guess you sort of learn that through the state titles and national titles when you can speak their language in Australia.
Yes.
But really not to the international swimmers, no.
Right, so there's sort of camaraderie between all the swimmers.
No. Oh, between Australian swimmers, but definitely not between your competitors in the marshalling area.
So you hate them. Who do you hate the most?
Who do you hate swimming against? You go, oh, bam, me, not another Kiwi to swim against.
Well, I used to swim against Anna Simsek all the time, so it was from New Zealand, so yeah. It was always great.
Well, you hated her.
Well, I had to, because I had to race against her. I had to beat her.
Yes, of course.
But when you get against international people that don't speak your language, you can always have the international language of the greasy, so... And that's, you know, the old...
Greasy?
Yeah.
What's that?
The old horrible look.
Oh, yeah.
But in the Commonwealth Games that we just saw there, you know, it was tactically that you wanted to get in this lane one so as they couldn't see you. Now, how often would you go for that rather than trying to blitz the field in the heats and say, catch me if you can?
Well, I didn't really think about getting in lane one. I was swimming freestyle for the first 2 days of Commonwealth Games, and when I was in the marshing area for my backstroke, I was closing my eyes trying to visualise my race, but I kept on visualising freestyle and I was swimming backstroke, so it was really
hard.
Easy trap.
Yeah.
Now, can I ask a question comparing Australia with the... world swimming scene at the moment, vis-a-vis our clean sweep in the pool at the Atlanta Games, the Commonwealth Games. I think this is the prelude to the clean sweep in all events at the Sydney 2000 by Australian athletes. It's very hard to line up when there's no Olympic Games going on where we actually sit in the world. Obviously, a truism, because we're not racing against the best in the world. Now, how do you think we're going vis-a-vis the clean sweep in the pool Atlanta in next year?
I think we're going really well. You just have to look at our world rankings, and we've got so many athletes in the top three or four in the world. But if you go from Commonwealth Games, your national championships, we have 20 or 30 champions. Mm. Then you go to Commonwealth Games, you have 16 or so champions.
Yes.
And then we go to world championships, and we only had 3 champions. So sort of the numbers drop off. And But if we can come out with 3 or 4 gold medals at the next Olympics from swimming, then that's going to be really good.
Yes, well, I don't think that's good enough.
And I shouldn't, let you go without noticing that the Australian Institute of Swimming has cut the pay for swimmers, or cut the handout for swimmers. And I'm just wondering how people in your position actually make ends meet. You're away representing Australia a lot of the time. The rest of the time you're at all sorts of places with the high altitude training, et cetera, doing the weights or whatever it is, thinking about the opposition, looking at the Chinese blokes coming to swim against you and all this sort of stuff. Can't we put some pressure on the Australian Institute of Sport and the swimming department in particular to bump up the salaries for our swimmers?
It's actually Australian Swimming and the Australian Sports Commission. They're having a bit of an argument at the moment as to how much funding Australian Swimming has left in their kitty.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty lucky. I'm employed by Australia Post, and they give me time off to train every day and pay me while I go away to compete for Australia. So that's how I personally make ends meet. But there's not very many athletes that are employed in Australia. So really we need companies out there to employ athletes and pay them while they're away swimming for Australia.
Like Australia Post. Well, that's a big rap for Australia Post.
Enormous rap for Australia Post. What do they do again, Roy?
We deliver.
And I was going to say, and your daily regime of swimming, is it, as you point out, more concentrating on the technique, or just is there a certain number of kilometres that you have to do each day to keep at world level?
Yeah, there is a certain amount of kilometres, and it gets pretty hard just before a main competition. So we'll swim up to probably 120 kilometres per 10 days before we go to Pan Pax. It's a lot of laps.
Well, it's only 12 kilometres a day.
It's not very much.
Well, it's not much.
No.
That's not much at all. I'm disappointed. In my day, we used to sometimes do 120 kilometres in a day. Dragging a bag of concrete.
In very slow pools. With that cheery note, Nicole, take our very best wishes from Club Buggery to the team, and all the best to yourself in the coming Pan Pax. And I ask the audience in the hangar here to thank Nicole Stevenson. It's tremendous to see Australians swimming in such capable hands. What made you give it away all those years ago? I mean, you obviously represented Australia at Commonwealth Games, Pan Pax in the early days, or the forerunner to Pan Pax, which was just in Tokyo, and then you went on to so many Olympic Games. You know, obviously you were as tough as bird poo on the car roof, when it came to swimming. Why did you give it away? Was somebody telling you it was time to give it away?
Well, in part, I my body was telling me to give it away, but Grassy got me aside. I think I was about 27, and I think it was the day I'd swum This was at the international level, the 50 metres, the 100 metres, the 200 metres, the 300 metres, the 400 metres, the 500 metres, an unusual event, the 500, the 1,000, the 1,400, the 1,800, the 3,000, that is the 3,200, I should say, the 6,400, the 1,978, which is a very odd Danish event. And I've done all that in one day.
Yes, yes.
And Grassy said, are you tired, Roy? Because I'd won a few medals on the day.
Oh, you would have. You would have. You would have
about 40.
Yeah.
And I said, yes, Grassy, I am. Yeah. And with that, I bade farewell to swimming. And I must say, I do miss it. And one day, like Joe, I might threaten to come back.
Well, with that note, speaking of stars, speaking of fitness, let's go over and have a look at some extraordinary people doing ordinary things. Let's go to a place where the cheese is always melted and the flute's always full. Let's go to Ian's.
This Sporting Life presents Ian. With Paul Surinam as Ian, Lisa Forrest as Susan, Cole Joy as Ian's dad, Greg Matthews as Ian's friend Cole, Annette Shunwar as Susan's friend Deirdre, Ted Mulry as Bob the neighbour, and introducing Warren Boland as Cole's mate Pete.
Well, it's like a weird dream.
You don't know too much about it, do you, Pops?
No, not much at all.
Tourette's syndrome, it's a weird one. Maybe I could do something about it on the show.
That's a great idea, Ian.
I'll run it past Ray.
Another cup of tea, Pops?
No, I'll get it. Thanks, love. I don't want you overdoing it.
Guess what?
What?
Ray's just pulled up out the front. Ray!
Ray's here! Ray's here! Ray Martin, Ray's coming in here.
Bugger me undies and plunge the result.
Just you shut up, all right, Pops?
Christ, everyone just be normal.
Oh, hi, Ray.
G'day, mate.
Come in.
Come in.
Ray,
this is
Colin and Peter. Hey, Colin.
Hi,
Ray. Pete. And nice to meet you.
Bob and Deirdre.
Hi.
And this is Dad over here.
Nice to meet you, anyway.
Oh, and this is Susan.
Hi. Heard the news. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Fantastic. Well.
Would you like a seat, mate?
Yeah, here, Ray. Or here, here. Here, Ray
might like to be over here.
Well, actually, I probably should go. But, how's the kitten, Susan?
Oh. Great. Great.
Good. Terrific. Good. Well.
I fish.
And I'm having a baby with Bob.
Great. Oh, and Pete and I have opened up a furniture shop, Ray. Right.
Yeah. It's great.
Great. I probably should go, I think. Ian, I'll see you on Friday.
Sure, mate.
Nice to meet you. Bye.
Bye.
What a nice bloke.
Yeah, tops.
Yeah.
I thought he was a bit like Bert Newton.
Oh, I thought he was a dream.
What do you think, Pops? Bloody hell. I think I'm cured.
Look, we haven't had a chance to address problems in the AFL that have bobbed up and are strangling the code to within an inch of its life and very existence. There's the problem of club mergers. There's the problem of wrestling boundary throw-ins and ball-ups around the ground, which I think is a big blight on the game. And finally, there's the problem of gloves. Now, gloves, I think, are the thin edge of the wedge. They've been banned in the VAFA, they've been banned by the VSFL, but they still exist in the AFL, and it does disappoint me. Look, I'm not against gloves per se.
No.
I think if you're a butcher and you manage to have an accident with the bandsaw and maybe lop off three fingers on a Thursday night with a big match coming up on Saturday, you should be able to wear a glove for cosmetic reasons. Obviously, if you've jagged yourself with, a fish hook and infected a thumb and it's oozing pussy, weeping sort of substances, it's wise to put a stall ball at least on that thumb or a glove on the hand
itself.
A poultice. Yeah. Impact inside, obviously, for once again health reasons. Gloves, I think they're ruining the game, Roy. I think you don't get any ball on the string merchants left.
No.
You get the ball on the glove idea and people are running around showing the ball, holding it upside down, doing all sorts of funny things with it. And in the end, it's against the spirit of the game and why we invented the bloody thing in the first place,
yes,
which is get the ball and kick it through the goals. I mean, we don't want to see gloves in the right.
No, I'd agree with you, Ash. I think we should remind people of just what gloves are like, in case some people have been away and they haven't seen gloves in use, say, at the MCG. I think if we can go to footage now, we'll see Gary Ablett with a glove to begin with.
A one-handed glove.
A one-glove man.
Michael Jackson style.
Yes.
God only knows why he just wears one. We all know he's God and not Michael. There's some people bought their own gloves. Here's another glove, Swans player, looking an absolute pont. Here's somebody who gets run into the fence. And I put that down simply to the fact that he was wearing a glove.
I agree with
Have you. Got a
Well, I don't know where it'll end. I mean, how thick is a glove? It's 1-2 millimetres thick. Well, could you have a 10 millimetre thick one, then a 40 millimetre thick one, then an 80 millimetre thick one, and then sort of that bloody stupid putter that Peter Senior uses, the broomstick. You'd get a bloody glove out here about 10 kilometres long, and that would help you sort of grabbing the ball. So I don't know where it's going to end, but I do recall, and I think a line has got to be drawn somewhere. I remember many, many years ago playing with the Lithgow Shamrocks, and we were playing Orange Sims from memory, or it might have been Bathurst St Patrick's, I'm not quite sure. We're in the dressing room, and Stomper Staines, Stomper's a terrific bloke, Stomp wore gloves, he was wearing gloves in the changing room, he had his shorts on, his Guernsey and gloves. And Grass didn't like him wearing gloves, understandably. So Grassy just got out a piece of chalk, as he often carried in his pocket, just a piece of chalk, drew a line across the floor, the concrete on the dressing room floor, and said, no one's going to stand over that, just stay on the other side of that line. Well, that was a red rag to a bull to someone like Stomp, and the rest of us, but we just ignored it. Stomper trot over the line. Stood over the line, as you would, and Grass got had a fence parting with him, and smashed him right across the bridge of the nose. And blood ensued, as you'd imagine, and Stomp was recalling as he was, still with the glove, you know, wiping up the blood with the glove. And Stomp said to Grass, you know, what'd you do that for? And he said, because you trod over the line. And he said, well, why can't I trot over the line, Grassy? He said, because I'm going to smash you over the nose with a bloody fence pole. Take the glove off. He took the glove off. Yeah. And I think that's what's got to happen. You've got to draw a very clear line with these gloves. A very clear line that says if you're gloved and over this side of the line, you're going to get a fence punny across the bridge of the nose. And if you're on that side, you haven't got a glove on and you look good and you're going to be able to play. And people are not going to laugh at you saying, where'd you get your broken bloody nose? Simple as that. I think it's an old technique. It's a very, very old idea. It goes all the way back to a dressing room in a very obscure place on the Blue Mountains, and it can work in 1995 with the AFL.
Roy, the trouble is, of course, the AFL don't want to take a decision. They've shunted it down to the clubs.
Because they're gutless.
I know. The clubs don't want to take a decision.
Because they're gutless.
Weak and always think about merging. They've got nothing else on their mind. The coaches don't want to take a decision. Yeah. The players don't want to take a decision. And once again, it's up to the public, the sports-loving public, the football-loving public of this nation, to boycott matches and players that wear gloves. If you see a player like those clowns we had up on the screen a moment ago in the street, give them a good load of golly from Roy and me and say, take off the gloves. If you don't want any more of this, take off the gloves. It's going to be as simple as that because the people will cause change here, Roy.
I think if people went armed with fence palings,
they'd get the message.
Well, if you got 40 or 50 blows across the bridge of the nose from the crowd whenever you went by because you were wearing a glove, if you had 50 or 60, if your nose was just a bit of gristle dangling on with a bit of skin.
Dental floss wrapped around and tying it to the hole in the head.
But there's nothing there to blow anymore. I don't think you'd wear gloves.
And now let's leave the world of football and go to the world of song. Ladies and gentlemen, can you throw your caution to the wind? Can you
throw
your pants and toupees in the air and welcome not only the Stones, not only the V8 dancers, not only the Nissan Cedrics, but Miss Jane Scali and her rendition of I'm Every Woman. Take the molars, Jane!
you want them, baby, I'll do it naturally.
Sliced Alone, I almost married a vampire arrangement of I'm Every Woman. It's a tremendous lively rendition, Roy. Look, the first time I heard that song was this week, actually, for the first time. I was with you.
Yep.
We were with Pamela Anderson and Tommy Lee, and the doctor burst out with the results of Pamela's pregnancy test, and he said simply, "Eureka, Pamela, you're pregnant."
Yes.
It was a terrific moment, wasn't it? And then over the hospital PA, that tune struck up.
It was a very moving moment. I didn't know how Tommy was going to take it, but Tommy said to me privately, "Roy, I'm over the moon."
Did he? Dream come true?
Dream come true, and we're shooting for twinnies.
Twinnies?
Twinnies.
Was those Tommy's words?
That's what Tommy's, that was Tommy's words. Yes. Over the moon. What was the other one?
Dream come true.
I'm shooting for twinnies.
You know, when I heard him say that, I thought he was saying he was shooting for quinnies. And I thought, hello, five.
What does that mean? Oh, five!
I thought...
Well, maybe he did say quinnies. I wish him all the best. If anyone could do it, Tommy could.
Indeed he could. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to welcome a man who is the most recognisable face of the Victorian Police Force when he pulls on the Peter Faithful gear. Nissan Cedrics, can you complete the identikit picture? That is the Simon Westaway story. Thanks for coming in and helping us with our inquiries, Simon. Now, before I let our dog handler, Senior Sergeant Roy Slaven, off the leash for a bit of a dig around in the backyard, I understand you're largely self-taught as an actor. How did you go about it?
I went to a school that had a lot of acting in it, and we did a play every year. First play was in grade two, Ringmaster.
Big!
And fortunately, because of that school, I maintained contact with theatre. When I left school, I kept doing non-professional theatre. And I just figured I had a few friends who were getting paid, and I figured I was better than they were, so I had a crack at being professional.
And
the rest is history.
Yes, and the rest is Phoenix and Janus.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, a lot of people don't know the musical side of your work. You know, obviously the Blues Brothers speaks for itself. How did you get into that side of it too, and did that require the same sort of treatment? You know, you just thought, oh, well, I put myself in for everything. If I land on my feet in the music with the soft shoes and so on with a cane and the funny hat, you know, you'd take it on?
Basically, what happened was that when I started, it was all musical theatre at school, you know, those old sort of British farces. And then when I left school, Whitehorse Musical Theatre Company, which was a company down in Melbourne, which they're still active, but they're trying to close the old theatre down, which is not so good. Sure. But basically, I maintained that musical line. And my first professional play was just a straight play, and then the Rocky Horror Show came along. Right. And I got the part of Brad. And, of course, that's a bit of a musical and...
Off your shirt.
Nudie, yes.
Yes,
well, you've been nude a couple of times, haven't you, Peter? You did... Simon.
It's okay.
So convincing was the role. We'll get to that in a moment.
That's the nude role.
Now, you did Foreskin's Lament, didn't you?
Yes.
The Greg McGee play, a New Zealand play, right, about rugby union, in which, in the first act, you would have had to have emerged from a shower nude with the other players.
Yes.
How was that? Was that difficult, Simon, for you? To drop the togs, probably in an intimate theatre, and was there, I mean, was it nerve-wracking imagining that, you know, things downstairs might have a mind of its own, sort of thing? I mean...
Well, especially being in Melbourne, we did this in July and it's pretty cold down there, and I remember one night we did it for the Victorian State Rugby side, and these blokes had never been to a play in their lives. And there's this one scene in the first act where I'm talking to Tupper, who was our coach, and you're there in the just a towel in your hand. And the bloke yells out from the back of the theatre, "It's cold, is it, mate?" And it was a bit like, "Yes, it is," you know.
Yeah.
But it was challenging, and, you know, they're very close. It's like this, and being naked here.
Well, were there any backstage antics like hot water to put it into, sort of, you know?
Yeah, there was one particular actor who used to like giving a bit of a tug before he went back out stage.
Obviously,
you get good reviews, incidentally.
Oh, life was a bit of a drag then, I think.
Now, did you learn these tricks by reading books, or did they come fairly natural to you? I noticed you list, for instance, as your favourite influences, people like Gene Hackman and Harvey Keitel as actors, and I often have trouble imagining what they did in similar positions, you know.
I like their work because I can see them thinking. Mm-hmm. And I think that was one of the best things about Janus and Phoenix, was because the scripts were so strong, the words were all there for you and it was a great story. But it also allowed you as an actor the luxury of being able to formulate your own plan.
Yeah.
And that's why I like watching those types of actors, because I can see the wheels going around. And for me, that type of performance is very interesting to me. And I like their skills.
We should...
And some fine Australian actors too.
Yes, indeed. We should have, to remind people of your work, we should have a little bit of a look at an excerpt from Janus.
Yeah.
If we can have a look at that now.
Yeah, we've cut a couple of eps together.
Yes, here's Simon as Detective Peter Faithful. Has a look out the window there, and I think Mal might be on his mind.
That's Leonard Teal running across the...
Yeah, that'd be right. Yeah. That would be right. Yes, and you're thinking, God, a lot of cars, must be Mal.
No.
Yes. So then you're off to catch Mal, and you've got to alert VKC to the fact that you're in a car and you've arrived.
Yes, the radio communications.
Yeah.
Getting out of the car. Going
Getting out of the car. Now, what I like about this scene in particular, Simon, is how naturally the police behave in car parks. He doesn't... the bloke up there didn't slam the door. He just sort of pushed the door. And, gee, I don't think you'd pull focus in any car park looking like this. Very naturalistic, you'd have to say.
Actually, this was a day when our director was sick, so...
You did this yourself?
We're actually busted, really.
What I like is this shot where you look through the binoculars, but it comes up as though you're looking through a telescope.
Yeah.
I suppose people have pointed that out to
the post-production nightmare, Yes.
But tremendous, and obviously they're going to, you know, try and hit that...
payroll
trial. Payroll.
Struggling for the lines here, which is...
Yeah.
They're going for a payroll.
Yep.
Here we go.
Here we go.
There's too many civilians to risk. We'll take them with a car. Danny, where are you?
South of you.
Right, if you can come up from the east and enter opposite bus lane.
Yeah, no.
You can come in diagonally from the northeast.
No, a tremendous scene.
Fantastic.
And the whole series, I must say, was probably the high watermark of Australian television.
Thank you.
Did it disturb you that it did, while it was critically, phenomenally successful, that it really didn't get the number of viewers that it deserved?
Well, I mean, it has an appeal to a certain type of viewer, I think. And the beauty, of course, is that doing a show like this, we get a chance to go out to country areas of Australia and visit people. Yeah. And there are a lot of people in the country who don't get anything other than the ABC. Yeah. And I'm grateful, and I think that they were grateful that they got a show like Jonas.
Yeah.
And I think we produced the best type of show of its kind in Australia to date.
Yes.
And being a part of that was very exciting.
So has it changed your life at all? I mean, do you go into shops and people behave a bit shifty or, you know, because they...
Half price at McDonald's, yeah.
No questions asked. You haven't paid for fish and chips since.
Yes.
You finished work recently, though, on a quite a different project, a film project with Belushi.
Yes.
John Belushi.
Jimmy Belushi.
Jimmy Belushi. Yes. Sorry, of course, I keep forgetting.
John's brother, James, yes.
That's right. Now, how did that come about? And I understand we recreated Africa in Newcastle.
Northern Newcastle.
Northern Newcastle.
It was a remake of a film called Sahara, and it was a Bogart film, and James came out to do the lead role. And they employed quite a few Australian actors, and I got a part playing an Australian soldier.
Yes.
And originally it was written as a South African character, and he was a bit of a whinger, and I think that what was good there, we had the freedom to make him a good, dare I say it, intelligent Australian soldier, and he wasn't just a patsy to the American leads.
Yeah.
So, but we also had a lot of fun. I mean, we had tanks, we had planes, we had 150 German soldiers. I remember firing this Bren gun, and the Bren gun shells go down, and it was a bit hot there down there for a while.
Yeah, yeah. That'd
be pretty tricky. Yeah,
Bren gun's a terrific gun to fire.
Absolutely.
It's a terrific.
Yes,
it's a shooter's gun.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it's a military man's weapon.
Yes.
In the original, was there an Australian?
No. It was a South African character.
Yeah.
And because it was done for TriStar Pictures up on the Gold Coast through Warner Brothers, they felt that because they were doing it here, they created this character, which was an Australian, and I was fortunate enough to get the part. It was a terrific opportunity because there were no women in the show. Not that's a bad thing, but it's the first time that a movie's been made in Australia with just male characters for a long, long time. And that's a bit like what I would expect to be playing like in, say, a league, you know, team environment.
Well, how's Jimmy Belushi? Was he good? Is he still in town?
No, James went back to Hawaii. He did a film back-to-back here. He did Sahara and Race the Sun.
Right.
Look, he's a lovely guy.
Yep.
And I've met a few American actors, and perhaps my perception of them was a little bit, you know, like a cigar and all that. But Jim was a really nice guy. I think that his experience with working with Australian actors rekindled his passion for acting.
Yep.
Dare I say it? And I know that he said that, so I feel comfortable in saying that. And you know, it was a great. It was a good ensemble. You know, we had some terrific guys.
Did he do any lines of coke or anything like that? I mean, was there any, you know, he would have done hooch, obviously, but any grass or horse or any of that sort of...
Well, I don't think there's too many dealers up around Newcastle. We were out in the boonies too, so...
Yeah.
I think that was one of the good things about this particular film. I mean, you know, like a lot of those guys, I think, have done all that when they were younger. And Jimmy doesn't do that sort of stuff. And perhaps he doesn't do it because of what his past was with Saturday Night Live and those types of shows.
Not to mention the problems of his brother.
Yeah. Well, I think that was a learning experience. And, you know, he loves, continues to love his brother. And they have a very close family.
Oh.
And, of course, when the book was written about his brother, I don't think that went down like a barrel of ice in his family. But no, he's a great man, and I was very fortunate to work with him and learn from the other guys. I mean, there was a guy there from The Crow, Michael Massey, there was another guy there, Robert Wisdom, you know, he's been playing Othello in London. I mean, there were some good actors amongst it, so it was a good opportunity for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Look, we could talk forever, but now we've got to move on to You Must Remember This.
Yes.
Now, it's a simple game for simple people, and the prize is tremendous, as usual. There's a Roy and HG Live Across Australia tape. There's the Date Finger T-shirt. This is the one they all want. And all these things, I'm proud to say, are available at ABC shops now, including, yes, you wanted it, and at last we've done it for you, the Ian Plate. Now, ladies and gentlemen, no self-respecting view of Club Buggery would want to have their mantelpiece unadorned by this magnificent plate. Yeah. All plates have the certificate of authentication signed by HG and Roy. I think this is plate number 0016 we're giving away tonight.
Yep.
But order them now. They are available at ABC shops. And if only they had that for Jonas, a plate. It's a Peter's dial on it as... Should I say Simon's dial on it as Peter. Roy, whose Simon playing
Simon,
for?
Simon, he's playing for a very special couple here tonight. We have Joy and Jim Anton from Perth, who are celebrating their 20th wedding anniversary with us. Where are they? There we are, there, yes. Joy and Jim have... they've driven all the way from Perth. Yes, it's a very long drive, and they've done very well. Now, you'll be playing for them. We've got a bit of footage here. It'll stop or freeze. Then, by gestalt, you'll tell us what happens next. If we look at the film now, there's the shark. It's Shinnycock, looking tremendous. And in a moment, we'll see him address the ball as only the shark can. What happens next?
Goes around the cup and doesn't get it in.
Well, let's have a look! That'd be sharky if it did.
There it goes. Whoa! The central commentating position here, I ask everyone in the Bomber Beazley Hangar to throw them together and thank Simon Westaway. Only the police were a bit more like Simon. I think the society was better
off. Yes, much better off.
And now our regular viewers of Club Buggery will know this is the spot where we pay homage to fallen comrades, no matter what their field of endeavour. Tonight we stand together in silent attention here in the Bomber Beazley Hangar in the desperate hope that new life can be breathed into the Australian Indoor Tennis Tournament, which fell off the twig this week after 22 years of sheer tennis pleasure. We hope we can find a new venue and new balls. Ladies and gentlemen, we stand together in silence tonight to celebrate a song made famous by Dean. It's a tremendous song. It's simply called Ain't That a Kick in the Head, to be performed by the man who's done more for footwear, that is sporting footwear, than Mr. Adidas himself. I refer to Steve Monteghetti. Take it away, Steve!
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in the boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. I've sunshine enough to spread. It's just like the fella said. Tell me quick, ain't love a kick in the head? Once said, ain't that a kick in the head? Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. She's telling me we'll be wed. She's picked out a king-size bed. I couldn't feel any better or I'd be sick. Tell me quick, boy, ain't love a kick. Tell me quick.
Out
Yeah, so when we began this mix spot 10 or so years ago on Club Buggery, we had no idea it'd have the sort of legs it has had over the years. Look, we get more mail about the meat tray than any other item, and tonight we've cooked up a doozy. It's all processed meats. These are meats that have had a lot of human
interference.
We've got a magnificent length of rowdy toot there and a couple of lovely rag blade roysters to go with them. Take us through the rest of it, Roy.
Yes, we don't quite know what this is, HG. All we know is it's good. And this one is more you're on the way out than on the way in.
Some nights that can be so
it's
appropriate.
Just the one. Yeah. Often, let's say you had Lady Renouf coming around, or that's the one you'd pull out. Now, it's all there, and it's been won this evening.
Nicole Livingstone, when she was here, spotted
yes,
a likely
someone.
Winner. And Roy, who yep. has won this magnificent meat tray this
yes,
evening?
Yes, here we go. Congratulations. Enjoy it all. I'd avoid that, but the rest is just terrific. Good.
And now we come to the very popular infotainment section of the show, and tonight Tools' Gifts once again is on the agenda. We find out what Mimi McPherson is thinking when it comes to hardware.
Tools as Gifts with Mimi McPherson.
It's never too early to start thinking about Christmas. And while it's easy to lay-by something that comes in a box with a bag, needs three-phase power and a 12-metre extension cord, does it really say anything more than the simple gift of a saw? It's funny, I gave Gary Ablett a fret saw 3 years ago. He loved it. I gave Lee Friedman a tenon saw as a thank you gift after the last spring carnival, and can remember giving Jimmy Barnes a rib saw to take to France with a simple note saying, Bon voyage, Barnesy. But for today, I'm here at the workshop thinking Leo Gagan, and naturally enough, I'm thinking spanners. I haven't a clue what sort he really needs, so I've dived into the deep end and gone with a 10-inch adjustable. I'm confident he'll love it, because I do.
Thanks, Mimi. That's great.
See what I mean? Tools. It's that simple.
In the Rugby League Test, Australia v New Zealand, Roy, a bit of an upset here.
Yes, it was an upset. Australia 26, New Zealand 8, and they deserved it.
In the AFL, at the MCG, Essendon 10-18, sloppy kicking from Kevin Sheedy's boys, Hawthorne 8-12, so a win to the Bombers by 18 points there. And Roy, I'm torn between so many things this weekend about what to do. I was going to go to the Continental Cafe in Greville Street, Paran, and see Vinnie Jones yes. go round. Yes. No one gets the high seas like Vinnie. And then I'm caught between, because I've got this other engagement. I love Lonnie Lee. I know I've said this on this program many, many times. Lonnie Lee and the Starlight Band, and Shan Romero is teaming up with Lonnie, the hippie joke man. So he's going to be on at the, I think it's the Bank Canterbury Hillston Park RSL tomorrow night. So there's a plethora of things to do. What are you off to, Roy?
Well, actually, I think I'm going to go to South's Juniors to see Tony Pantano.
Oh, yeah.
I've loved Tony for many, many years now. I'm going to arrive about 3 o'clock. Because Tony's on at 8, and I want to get a very good seat. So if anyone wants to join me, be there at 3, we'll make up a bit of a party, we'll just go right up the front and sit in our seats, and we can amuse ourselves for a few hours until Tony appears. But it's a tremendous night, and up close you see bits of Tony you don't see.
What, from the back
when
of the
you're
room?
Up the back, no.
Well, then, they're the rowdy bits.
That's right.
Unfortunately, we have to sign off from the Bomber Beazley Hangar tonight, and on behalf of, obviously, Bomber himself, who can't be here, Simon Westaway, Nicole Stevenson, Jane Scali, the V8 Dancers, the Stones and the Cedrics, and you, the audience, whether here in the hangar or there at home. And I know a lot of people do like to get the green light to start fiddling. Well, the green light is on now. So if you're at home under the doona, get to it. You've got Roy and my permission to get on the job straight away. You don't have to wait till the end. But I think, Roy, if I had to sum up tonight's show, the best is still to come.
It's about to happen. He's here. The big one. The big man.
Yes, he's been at the Club Buggery canteen for some time eating tripe. Now, so I think you'll know why when you see the gear, because here he comes, the giant of the G-chord. They come on down, man. Mr. Ian Taps Tappy and Minnie the Major. See you next week.
Here's the story about Minnie the Moocher. She was a low-down hoochie-coocher. She was the roughest, toughest frail, but Minnie had a heart as big as a whale. Hidey, hidey, showed her how to kick the gong away. Everything that she wasn't needing.
He gave her a home made of gold and steel.
A diamond car with a platinum wheels.
And every meal she ate was a dozen courses.
And $1 million worth of nickels and dimes.
And she counted that loot about a million times.
Your wedding.
There was very little that John and